We cannot write like the English. We should not. We cannot write wholly as Indians. We have grown up to look at large world as a part of us. Hello everyone. Today at Lit Critique, we'll be looking at one of the main documents in Indian writing in English, that is the Foreword to Kanthapura by Raja Rao. So when we look at Indian writers who write in English, so there are three main pillars which form the base for this genre of literature in India. So when we look at when we look at them, so the three names are the Mulk Raj Anand at first, who is considered as one of the greatest writers who wrote about caste and atrocities of lower caste people in India, in rural areas majorly. And then who doesn't know R.K. Narayan, who's at second, who is a legendary author of Malgudi Days, one of the greatest anthologies of Indian writing, more probably the English writing in India. So the third writer which we are looking at today, and one of the most important writers again, is Raja Rao. So when we talk about Raja Rao, so we think of that person who brought this change of approach of looking into this Indian English. So obviously, so we know that Britishers colonized us and they introduced English into India when we look into Macaulay's Minutes and all. But this language and a dialect which is called as Indian English wasn't known to the world back then. So today obviously we have writers like Salman Rushdie who took Indian English to a whole different level, who have won bookers. We have Arundhati Roy, but the person who started this whole thing was Raja Rao. So Raja Rao wrote a book known as Kanthapura, so which deals about the problems that are caused to local people in villages, and also it has a vivid village scenery and also landscapes, so which bring in that dynamic effect into Indian writing. So we have Rabindranath Tagore before him, so who wrote poetry, and his poetry Gitanjali won the Nobel Prize, so which again remains to this day the only Nobel Prize won by an Indian for literature. So no other Indian has won any other Nobel Prize for literature. When we look at Raja Rao's biography, so we notice that he was educated in Paris. He taught in university in France, and then he came back to India to write. And he wrote many, many, many novels and many short stories, which became one of the greatest works of Indian writing in English. So when we look at this Foreword to Kanthapura by Raja Rao, so we again notice the argument that he makes, that Indian English is not anymore a foreign language that we call. So Indian English has become a local language by now, and it is the same as different as American English or Irish English or Australian English for that matter. He tells that Indian English itself is a totally different kind of dialect which has to be accepted worldwide. So let us look at this document paragraph by paragraph and look into the characteristics and also the arguments that Raja Rao makes. My publishers have asked me to say a word of explanation. There is no village in India, however mean, that has not a rich Sthala-purana or legendary history of its own. Some god or godlike hero has passed by the village. Rama might have rested under this peepal tree. Sita might have dried her clothes after her bath on this yellow stone, or the Mahatma himself on one of his many pilgrimages throughout the country might have slept in this hut, the low one by the village gate. In this way, the past mingles with the present, and the gods mingle with men to make the repertory of your grandmother always bright. One such story from the contemporary annals of my village I have tried to tell. So this first paragraph tells about many things that Raja Rao wants to tell. So basically he starts with this idea that every place in India has this Sthala-purana or a local legend that is attributed to some kind of legend or some kind of historical personality. as he mentions that Rama, like Lord Ram, has might have come to this place and he has sat under this peepal tree, or might Sita might have sat on this rock, and so on and so forth. And when we look at all of these things, he talks about this form of writing that is called as Sthala-purana. And this particular novel, Kanthapura, is written in the form of Sthala-purana, in which this grandmother recites the whole story. So again, when we again look into all of these things, we notice the mingling of the national identity with this local identity, which again brings out a new flavor in literature. When we notice this classical as well as the rural folk legend of that particular place intermingling, we get to see a different kind of literature being born of that place. The telling has not been easy. One has to convey in a language that is not one's own, the spirit that is one's own. One has to convey the various shades and omissions of a certain thought moment that looks maltreated in an alien language. I use the word alien, yet English is not really an alien language to us. It is a language of our intellectual makeup, like Sanskrit or Persian was before, but not of our emotional makeup. We are all instinctively bilingual, many of us writing in our own language and in English. We cannot write like the English, we should not. We cannot write only as Indians. We have grown to look at the large world as part of us. Our method of expression, therefore, has to be a dialect, which will someday prove to be as distinctive and colorful as the Irish or the American. Time alone will justify it. As we can look in the second paragraph, Raja Rao makes this argument that English is not a foreign language anymore. It has been Indianized. And again, he tells that there is this a certain thought which has come to you, but it is very difficult to write it in a language that is not your own. But again, at the same time, he says that Indian English spoken in India is not a foreign language anymore. As a great Bengali writer, Sukumar Ray also talked about in his poetry collection Abol Tabol, there were Indians who were not again totally British in their mannerisms, or not totally Indian because already they have learnt English to some extent and they are speaking now in English. So now Indian English is now ingrained into the local people. So he talks about writing English in such a way that it becomes a totally different entity altogether. The same way as the English spoken in America or English spoken in Australia or English spoken in Ireland is totally different from the English spoken in Britain. So Raja Rao's ideas about sound, language and all the aesthetics that revolve around in the second paragraph again look back into the Vedic tradition, the rich Vedic tradition that we had, and the four levels of consciousness that are talked about in the Vedas are four, which is one is called as Para, which is a transcendent, then the Paschanti, which is the seeing or the illuminated watching or illuminated witness that we see from our own eyes. And the third one is Madhyama. Madhyama is a source of or a source or a medium of looking towards things. And the fourth one is called as Vaikiri, or the discourse of things or the general behavior of people. These are the four levels of consciousness that Raja Rao again put in the second paragraph, which are not visible from the outside, but these are a part of Vedic tradition that we had from centuries. After language, the next problem is that of style. The tempo of Indian life must be infused into our English expression, even as the tempo of American or Irish life has gone into the making of theirs. We in India think quickly, we talk quickly, and when we move quickly. There must be something in the sun of India that makes us rush and tumble and run on. And our paths are paths interminable. The Mahabharata has 2,14,778 verses, and the Ramayana 48,000. Puranas, there are endless and innumerable. We have neither punctuation nor the treacherous ats and ons to bother us. We tell one interminable tale, episode follows episode, and when our thoughts stop, our breath stops, and we move on to another thought. This was and still is the ordinary style of our storytelling. I have tried to follow it myself in this story. So Raja Rao in this third paragraph again makes out a really critical argument that he goes on to use in this novel Kanthapura. So he tells that as the Americans or the Irish have used their style of writing in English and their own particularities with the language, we have to do it ourselves. We have a tradition in India that Raja Rao talks about, that we stop very often and we just move on with the flow. Mahabharata has many verses, and again when he talks about Mahabharata and Ramayana, so there is this concept of the epic tradition, which again we'll be discussing in another video. But epic tradition in India is a little different from what epic tradition is in Greek culture and Greek tradition. So when we talk about Mahabharata and Ramayana, they are written in Sanskrit, and Sanskrit syntax is totally different from the English syntax. In Indian storytelling, and particularly in Sthala-purana, we jump into ideas and we jump into episodes and episodes and episodes. That is exactly what Raja Rao is talking about in this foreword. He tells that we have to adopt that style of telling, and in India, we are such a people that we spontaneously and we very fastly move towards one thing to the other. And this is a style of storytelling that he follows in this novel Kanthapura as well. It may have been told of an evening when, as the dusk falls and through the sudden quiet, lights leap out in the house after house, and stretching her bedding on the veranda, a grandmother might have told you, newcomer, the sad tale of her village. This last little paragraph forms the end of this marvelous foreword by Raja Rao. So in this again, he talks about how a grandmother tells a tale to the newcomer of the village about a sad tale. So that is exactly the thing he is going to do in this whole novel Kanthapura. He picks out a grandmother who will narrate the whole tale in this novel. The whole idea of Raja Rao is to bring back that tradition of Sthala-purana and write it in English. By writing it in English, he wants to take these stories to the colonizers as well as the whole world, which are intelligible to their language. But again, when we write it in the local language, it is only limited to the local people. But English at this point of time globally has become the language of international affairs and the language of international relations as well, because British Empire was at its zenith in after the First World War, and around 1920s and 1930s it was at its highest point. It almost covered like 35 million square kilometers, which is again the largest empire in the history of mankind. So Raja Rao and other writers in India like Mulk Raj Anand and R.K. Narayan wrote stories not only for Indians but also for the British to know our part of the story, and also our part of the heritage and culture that we carry and we have been carrying from so long. So when we read about these writers who wrote in English, who were the base, who set up a base for the future writers to bud in and also create some beautiful pieces of literature like The Midnight's Children by Salman Rushdie and The God of Small Things by Arundhati Roy. So these writers are a future generation of these three writers which I just mentioned, namely Mulk Raj Anand, R.K. Narayan and Raja Rao. By studying these writers who wrote at the time of the British Raj, we cannot help but to think back at the times when people lived in deplorable conditions and the literature was still very nascent when we think about Indian writing in English. So the English writings at that point of time were very nascent, and these people made up the base for the future writers to come by.